What we're going to do is just ask the Spirit of God to give us wisdom and revelation in what we have to say. Amen? Because that's, we all want to grow, and God's desire is for all of us to know the truth of the word. I was reading in Ephesians, I think it was chapter number 1 or 2, and that scripture said that truth is in Jesus. So he is the truth. And you know what all of this is all about at the end of the day? This is about him. Amen. This is about Jesus, and it's about us being able to find ourselves in him. And so I want to open this morning with just a very brief definition of the word grace, because we're going to be using that word quite a bit. Next week, I'm going to be sitting down in preparation for Women in Worship. And this is May and November, our pastor Skip's sabbatical months, where we give him time to just get his heart built up and get in the word. And so usually Pastor Tim will take November. Pastor Cheryl is coming right behind me. But today I'm going to kind of leave you hanging, and then we're going to pick up when I come back after Women in Worship. Is that all right? Yeah. All right. And so we're going to talk just a little bit about grace. I want to just share about grace with you all. A lot of people define grace as God's unmerited favor, and it is that, but sometimes that's a little bit blind to us. You know, that's sometimes it can sound like Christian jargon versus us really being able to see what is this thing called grace. It's God doing something for you that you did not ask him to. And it's God doing something for you, a favor for you, because he wanted to do it. It's not earned. You don't even deserve it. It's just God doing you a favor. And I shared in the first service that when I turned about 40 years old, I took my kids. Pastor Skip asked me what I wanted for my birthday, and I went to a car lot and bought my twins a new car. You know, and he was like, I asked you what you wanted. I said, this is what I wanted. I wanted to be able to bless my kids. I wanted to have the joy of being able to dangle keys in front of my kids saying, you can drive yourself to school. That's doing somebody a favor. My kids didn't ask for that. I did it because I wanted to do it, right? And so when you think about the word grace, that's the mindset that you need to have, that God does what he does for you because he wanted to do it. He just wanted to do you a favor. Everybody say favor.
Favor.
In Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, we're going to look at the Message translation of the Bible. And we're going to start there, and then we'll move into some other things. Look at Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. It says, by entering through faith into what God has always wanted to do for us. What has God always wanted to do? He's always wanted to set us right with himself, to make us fit for himself. We have it all together with God because of our master, Jesus. And that's not all. We throw open our doors to God and discover at the same moment that he has already thrown open his doors to us. We find ourselves standing where we always hoped we might stand, out in the open, wide, or the wide open spaces of God's grace. Say grace.
Grace.
And glory, standing tall and shouting our praise. And so look at the posture that you should have in grace. You shouldn't be bent over. You should be doing what? Standing tall in grace. That means that you have an understanding of what God has done for you through the person of Jesus Christ. You understand that you didn't do anything to earn it. You understand that it wasn't about you. It was about what he wanted to do, like me buying a car. Amen. So we're going to jump down to Romans chapter 5, verses 20 through 21, and look at that. And it says this. Remember last week I talked about the law and the 613 laws that we were trying to climb, and we couldn't do it, but then Jesus went on and did it for us. Remember that. Look at this. All that passing laws against sin did was produce more lawbreakers. But sin didn't and doesn't have a chance in competition with the aggressive forgiveness we call grace. When it's sin versus grace, what wins?
Grace.
Grace wins hands down. All sin can do is threaten us with death. And that's the end of it. Now, I was sharing in the first service that, you know, there's a couple of times that I've had to battle thoughts of dying. You know, you keep eating that, you're gonna die. You keep doing that, you're gonna die. When I was pregnant with my children, every one of my children, I had to fight thoughts of my children dying. What is that? That's sin threatening me. How many of you have ever had to fight thoughts of death? You're trying to figure out, why am I thinking about death? It's because sin threatens us and makes us think that we're going to die. But look at what the Bible says. All sin can do is threaten us with death, and that's the end of it. Grace, everybody say grace.
Grace.
Because God is putting everything together again through the Messiah, grace invites us into life. Sin is inviting us into death, but grace is inviting us into life. And look at this, it's a life that goes on and on and on, world without end. Now there's another translation that says this, that grace never stops giving or forgiving. Amen. So grace never stops giving or forgiving. That's the grace that we've been given by God. It's a grace that only gets stronger and stronger and stronger. And it gets stronger in the face of sin. So here we go. Pull in what Pastor Giles said. He said, you can never out-sin your grace. Why? Because where sin does abound, grace does much more abound. So wherever you see sin present, you need to be looking for the grace of God. Now, with this in mind, let's look at Romans chapter 6, verse number 1, because Romans chapter 6, verse number 1 starts with a question, because Paul is talking about all of this grace and all of this forgiveness and all of this stuff that God is doing for us and how he's moved. He didn't cover sin. Remember, I said he got rid of sin. And so now in light of all of that, Paul is now saying in Romans chapter 6, verse 1, he said this, well then, since grace goes on and on and on, since we're forgiven, should we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more of his wonderful grace? Verse number 2 says what? Read it loud.
Of course not.
Since we have, look at this, died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? Or have you forgotten that when you were joined with Christ Jesus in baptism, you joined him in his death? Dead man can't sin. Dead man don't sin. For we died and were buried with Christ by baptism. And just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, are y'all looking at this with me? Now, what does it say? We also may live new lives. Say, I live a new life.
I live a new life.
Now, I want to stop right here and I want to say this. People who teach that in this text, Paul is talking about water baptism is incorrect. He is not talking about water baptism. He's talking about us being baptized into Christ. It's a spiritual baptism, not an H2O baptism. I'm not saying we shouldn't be water baptized, but you'll note that this salvation verse of scripture, and it does not come as a result of being immersed in water, because as I said in first service, water saves nobody. Amen. A person has to be immersed in Christ for their life to change. This is a spiritual baptism, and we've been baptized into a person and not a thing. So let's keep reading. Verse number 5. Since we've been united with him in his death, we will also be raised to life as he was. We know that our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. We are no longer slaves to sin. Verse 7. For when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. of sin. And since we died with Christ, we know we will also live with him. Verse number 9, we are sure of this because Christ was raised from the dead and he will never die again. Now that's important to notice. He will never die again. What does that mean? He's never going to die for your sin again. He's already dealt with it once and for all. He's never going to die for your sin again. Now, if the work that Jesus did the first time wasn't good enough, that means he's going to have to die again. And the Bible says he did it once and for all. He's never going to have to die again. Look at the person next to you and say, he's not going to die again. Never gonna die again. But now look at this. When he died, verse number 10, he said death no longer has any power over him. When he died once to break the power of sin. But now that he lives for the glory of God. So you also should consider yourself to be dead to the power of sin and alive to God through Christ Jesus. What do you need to use to consider something? Say that loud. You have to use your mind to consider something, not your behavior. You got to use your mind to consider something, not your behavior. All right. When we look at the Word of God, it's easy to wonder if Paul isn't giving us, or what many call, a license to sin. There's so much love, so much forgiveness, so much grace. Where does this stop? Where is the line drawn? Reading this passage, it's clear to see that we will never out-sin our grace. And the Bible tells us in 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, that the blood of God's Son continually cleanses us from all unrighteousness. The powerful thing about grace is that grace looked down beyond your today and it dealt with your yesterday. Amen. Now, it's easy to embrace the fact that God forgave the sins that you committed yesterday, because you made the decision to come to Christ at some point in your life, a time where you felt remorse and regret for the past and your former lifestyle. So we came to him asking him to forgive us and to make us new, and he did that. That's not questionable, because we can recall when we did something that warranted us to have to ask for forgiveness. We weren't born again. We didn't know God. And so there's a landmark. We can tell you I got born again 1957. On my grandmother's step and all of that, it was a landmark. So we have this memory in our mind of the day that we made the decision to come to Jesus. But it gets a little more complicated to embrace the fact that God would forgive the sins that you have yet to commit. That he looks down the portholes of time at our sins and he forgives the sins that we will commit tomorrow. He's already addressed the sin that you will commit tomorrow. If he had not, he would have to die again. But he's already addressed it. Every sin that you and I will ever commit has already been addressed on the cross of Jesus Christ. Say amen. Amen. All right, I hope y'all with me. All right. Now, you know, that causes our brain to struggle just a little bit. And it's this truth that prompted Paul to even have to ask the question. Okay, see how good God is. Now you see that you're forgiven. Now you see his goodness. You gonna keep sinning? That's why he's asking the question. God forgives your sins. You haven't even committed them yet. Yeah, he does. So when we say you're already forgiven, it could appear that we're saying that you have a license to sin. But we're not saying that. But it's important to understand that God isn't distinguishing my past sins from my future sins. To him, they're all sin. And he doesn't care when they happen. They've already been forgiven and dealt with through the work of Jesus Christ. Now, I was thinking about this when I went in my office. You know, as my kids get older, there's just some things I gotta grade. It's like, now you still doing that. Now you need to quit that. As you get older, there's some things that my kids just shouldn't be doing because they know better. So we do have that element. You should know better by now. Right? But Jesus doesn't have to die again for that. This is what makes the power of forgiveness and the power of grace so potent, is that God can look down the timeline in his foreknowledge and know everything that you're going to do. He knew everything that you were going to do before you were even born, and he forgave you. Oh, that's good. But there's some people who may think, wow, God forgives my past, present, and future sins, then I can just do whatever I want to do. But here's what Paul said about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 23. They don't have this, but I'm going to read it to you. He said, you say, I am allowed to do anything. But then his response to that is, but not everything is good for you. Then he goes on to say, he say, you say, I'm allowed to do anything. But then his response to that is, but not everything is beneficial. So yes, you can do whatever you want to do because you are a free moral agent. But you need to know that there are consequences to the things that you do. See, you realize that what you want to do is rooted and grounded in where you are. When you realize that, then it will answer the question, what is it that you want to do? See, we have two places that we're dealing with. Before we gave our life to Jesus Christ, we were over in this, you know, in this space where we had a sin nature. You know, we would sin and whatever. But the Bible says that when we came to Jesus Christ, we were translated out of the kingdom of darkness and placed into the kingdom of his dear son. In this place, the way you walked was influenced by your location. What you did, how you thought, how you spoke, it was all influenced by your location. The Bible talks about your conversation. He's not talking about the words of your mouth. He's talking about your lifestyle. It's all rooted in where you come from, where you have been translated out of this kingdom and into the kingdom of God's dear son. And in this kingdom, we walk different. We talk different. We do things different. And in this kingdom is not ruled by sin. That kingdom is ruled by sin. That's why people on this side, we call them non-believers and sinners. That's why the people on this side, you can't get mad at them for sinning. You can't get mad at sinners for sinning. All they're doing is walking out what's in their, you know, in their DNA. But on this side, there's a different walk. There's a different lifestyle. So we're not giving you a license to sin by any means. You know, and I'm going to say this because I shared this in the first service. Sometimes when you've been over on this side for so long and you haven't yet made Jesus the Lord of your life, you got behaviors, habits, things that you get yourself involved in. And they mark you and people can tell that, you know, you've been dabbling in something. You got something on you. Don't matter what it is. And see, we categorize sin. We sit and we say that sin is worse than, ain't none of them worse than the other. They're all sin in the eyes of God. And so, we're over here, we're on this side, and, you know, we get involved in some things, you know. And, you know, some of those things, when you come over here, you still look like you did over there. We sing that song, I looked at my hands and my hands look new, looked at my feet and they did too. No, they don't. No, they don't. The only thing that changed is your spirit. You went from being spiritually born again, spiritually dead, to being spiritually born again. And so when you made the journey, if you will, you were transplanted out of one kingdom into God's kingdom. When you got on this side, you still had the same mind, so you still thought the same. You still had the same feet, so you still did things the same. And it's not until somebody can get the word of life into you to help you understand what is the language. Thank you, Holy Ghost. What is the language of this kingdom? What is the walk? What is the conversation of this kingdom? That's why you got to sit down somewhere so somebody can teach you some things. And so on this side, we learn that we don't have a lot. We're not even trying to sin. I came on this side because I got tired of sinning. Amen. Your old heart wanted to sin. But when we were baptized into Christ, my focus shifted. My heart changed. So here in Romans chapter 6, Paul is asking, did we read Romans? Did we read Romans? Y'all help me. We didn't read Romans 6 yet? The memory of the just is blessed in Jesus' name. So here in Romans chapter 6, Paul is asking a rhetorical question. When he asks, how can we continue to live in sin after we've died to it? Now, that question can be taken two ways. We can think that Paul is shaking his judgmental finger at us saying, how dare you live in sin after God has taken you out? Or he can be asking the question, how are you going to do that? How are you going to live in sin when there ain't none over there? How are you going to do that? And you got the nature of God in you. One translation says the seed of God. Another translation says says the seed of God is in you. God's DNA is in you. He's asking, how you gonna do that? And I believe that's what Paul is asking. How are you going to live in sin? But you got to look at 1 John chapter 3, verse 9. Because like Paul, John is asking a question. How can you live in sin and by that make a practice of sin is what we're talking about. Loving sin, desiring sin, craving sin, and getting better at sinning. How can you do that? Look at John 1, chapter 3, verse 9. 1 John. It says this. Read it with me. Ready? Read. Those who have been born into God's family, read it loud.
Do not make a practice of sin.
Why?
Because
God's life is in them. So we can't keep on sinning because they are children of God. He said, You cannot keep sinning. Now, he did not say that you can't sin. And he did not say that you won't sin. He said that if God's nature is in you, you can't keep sinning. You can't practice sinning. And how many of you know that there's a difference between doing something one time and practicing it? There's a difference between doing something a couple of times and practicing it. We were in the back and Eric came to me and he was talking about how the basketball players, you know, how I don't know sports, so if I don't get this right, don't hold it against me. But he said basketball players are shooting their baskets and they keep, you know, Kobe Bryant, I think he was talking about, said that he got up every day to shoot baskets and his goal was to perfect the game. Well, think about this. Do you think he made every shot? He didn't make every shot, but that didn't pull him out of being a basketball player and it didn't pull him out of the NBA. And if he missed shots while he was on the court in the middle of the championship game, the owners of the team didn't say, that's it, you can't play no more. We're going to disown you. I'm trying to make this plain. So you don't practice sin like Kobe practices the basketball. You don't practice sin. You may sin because you still got your flesh to contend with. And your flesh is a way of thinking that opposes the things of God. So you still got to deal with your flesh and you still have to deal with the devil. But it does not change the fact that you're in the NBA and you're on the team. So John is not saying that you'll never struggle with sin or that you'll never sin. He's not saying that. He's saying that you can't practice sinning. So you got to pay attention to the words that you're looking at in the Bible. Slow it down. How can you continue or keep living in sin is the question that he's asking. How can you make a practice of it when God's nature lives in you? How do you do that when you've been raised to a new place where there is no sin? When everything around you is goodness, mercy, blessings, favor. Amen. An unbeliever practices sin. It's compatible with who they are. They crave it. They want it. They'll dream up new ways to sin. You'd be like, how you do that? They'll dream up new ways to sin. And I was sharing in the first service that we were doing this outreach a couple of years ago with this guy. And he said, before I gave my life to Christ, he said, I woke up to do evil. That's the mindset of the unbeliever. You see, the reason you have this internal struggle if you're a Christian when it comes to sin is because it's inconsistent with the nature of God in you. It doesn't align with who you are. You can stop going to church and you can stay away from Christians, but what you cannot do is get away from yourself. You goes wherever you go. That fight in you is your Christ nature and the thoughts, ideas, and suggestions of the enemy that's teamed up with your flesh, they're ganging up on you. And this is why people can enjoy what they're doing outwardly, but inwardly they're miserable. How many of y'all know what I'm talking about? You the one at the bar talking about I shouldn't be in here. You the one that's doing wrong and know that it's like, Lord, forgive me. In the midst of it. The sin nature is not yours. It does not belong to you. It belongs to those that are not Christians. This is why Paul can make the statement that those who have the nature of God cannot make a practice of sinning. But he didn't say that you would never sin. You may go for an extended period of time, but your heart will be doing a number on you. Going back to Paul, he's posing the question, how should we keep sinning to just show how gracious God is? In many ways, he's asking, are you serious? How can you do that? Do you really think you're like the people in the world who don't know God? How can you live in sin any longer? You can't now that you're in Christ and you have a revelation of what happened to you. See, this is the issue. We're seated with Christ in heavenly places, but we won't get our mind up there. You won't put your mind up there. And because I think it was Parliament Funkadelic that said, well, I ain't gonna say that. He said, free your mind and your will follow. Father, forgive me for I've sinned. But it's the absolute truth. If you're where your mind goes, that's where your life goes. And so he said, set your mind. Remember what I did last week. Set your mind up here. Get your mind on things that are above where Christ is seated and where you are seated with him. Break it down. See, if I can get my mind up there and I start thinking high and lofty thoughts, the stuff down here won't bother me. You know, when I get up in an airplane, I love ascending. I love that whole feeling of going up in the airplane. I like that because, as I'm looking down, the houses get smaller. The people, I can't even see them no more. Stuff that I was worried about, I can't even associate it with it no more. Why? Because I'm up in the air and I'm thinking high and I'm thinking lofty thoughts. That's what he's saying. Get your mind up here. You get your mind up here, your life will follow. Sin will not be a problem for you. When you start thinking about the fact that I'm no longer under the law, but I'm under grace. Amen. I'm running out of time. Last week I said you got to think about the other side of the cross. And you do. The resurrected life is you thinking and remembering, I've been raised to newness of life. And because I've been raised to newness of life, there's just some behaviors that I just don't want to participate in anymore. I just don't want to do it anymore. And I make the decision to disassociate those things from my life. Can I sin? Yes, absolutely I can sin. I can do whatever I want to do. But I don't want to do that because it's inconsistent with the nature of God who lives on the inside of me. We're not giving you a license to sin. And you can't say that we said that. That's not what I'm saying. You don't have a license to sin. But you do have a license to life. You do have a license to live out the life of Christ through you. Because that's what he wants to do. He wants to live his life through you. But the only way that he can do that is by you setting your thoughts on things above. And I'm going to sit down with this. I read a scripture in the book of Ephesians where, and you know, for some reason my mind is slipping me where that scripture is. I believe it's in the second chapter of the book of Ephesians where it says that God has lavished on us grace and blessings. That he lavished. So if you get the idea, Mark, take your chair up there. Put your chair up there and then sit down in it. Aji, take another chair and sit next to him. If you get this in your mind, that this is what Jesus did for you, this is not Christian jargon. This is a reality. And I said this in the first service, just like you believe in Daniel in the lion's den, just like you believe that Jonah was in the belly of a whale with stomach acid all around him, just like you believe that the children of Israel walked through the Red Sea, you gotta believe that this is what God did for you through Jesus Christ. That same belief. Now look at this. This is God. Who's at the right side? Left, right. Here we go. We're in him, right? This is God the Father. We're in him. The book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse... What does it say? Verse number 7. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 7. Let's look at what it says. Somebody read it.
Starting at verse 6. And he hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness to
toward us in Christ. Read verse 8.
Verse 8 says, for by grace ye are saved through faith, that not of yourself,
it is a gift of God. Verse 7 is the verse I want to look at. It's another version. It is another version. I'm not sure whether it's the New Living Translation or the NLT. But it says that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding... Go back.
Amplified.
So God... This, go ahead.
He did this that he might clearly demonstrate through the ages to come the immeasurable, limitless, surpassing riches of his free grace, his unmerited favor, in his kindness and goodness of heart toward us.
What he wants to do is through you being raised up, this is why he did it, so that he can just lavish on you blessing, favor, goodness, mercy. Why? Just because he wanted to do it. And not only that, he wants the world to be able to see that he's poured his blessing and his favor out on you. When you have a mindset that you're seated in heavenly places with Christ, that song that says things of the earth become faintly dim. They become really dim. You're up there, but you're dealing and you're executing your life from down here. And he's saying you need to keep yourself up here because up here is where the wisdom of God. You see, where is God? Where God is where the wisdom is. And so when you think that you've been, when you have a mindset that remembers that I've been raised to newness of life, in Christ Jesus, no problem, no situation, nothing I have to deal with, he hasn't already dealt with. And if it's not fixed in my life, all I got to do is reach over to my Father. Thank you, guys. Here is the thing. We got to stop making so much of sin. We make too much of sin. Stop thinking about it. Stop talking about it. And start talking about the righteousness that you have been made. You are the righteousness of God. You've been seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. What would that look like if you made that a reality in your life? Because it's already done in the spirit. What would it look like in the natural if it was real in your natural life? If this manifested, if this brought itself from in here to out here, what would your life look like? Sin is not a problem for you. Are you gonna miss it? Yep. You're not gonna get everyone. You're not gonna get everyone. But you're not gonna stay over here. Ooh, I like missing it. Ooh, I like missing it. Ooh, I like missing it. No, you're not gonna stay over here. Everybody stand up. Father, we're so grateful for the grace of God that's resident in our lives. Everybody holler, grace.
Grace.
Thank you for the favor, Father, that you've done in our life. Thank you, Father God, that no matter what it is that we have done, that you are ever ready to forgive us, to receive us, to walk with us, to give us everything that we need, Father God, to be those that you've called us to be. And so we thank you for grace. Thank you for the truth of the Word of God. We're not going to try to out-sin grace. We're not going to make the decision to try to live in sin. Because you said that the ones that are in the family of God does not practice sinning. And so we thank you that the blood of Jesus is continually cleansing us from everything that's unrighteous. We appreciate you for that, Father. In Jesus' name we pray and we thank you. Amen. Amen.